Welcome back to Building Character, where we figure out how to play as your favorite fictional characters in Dungeons & Dragons. Remember to like and subscribe to go the distance next time you play. Maybe. Earlier this week, we built Hela, our third child of Odin, so I figured to keep things balanced, we need to build a third child of Zeus. Hercules is one of Zeus's more famous children, which is honestly saying something. The Disney movie helps, even if it makes his stepmom a little friendlier than she was in the original myth. He's fighting and biting and riding on his horse. Let's start off with our goals for this build. First, we need the strength of a god, or a demigod at least. Next, we'll make sure that we've got a flying horse friend. Finally, we'll get some abilities to defend the innocent. For stats, we're using the standard point array from the player's handbook. Roll if you want, just make sure your strength and charisma are up to snuff. Strength is going to be number 1. You've got 12 labors, and like 9 of them can be solved with lifting. Constitution after that, you've got to endure the wrath of a god. That requires thick skin. Dexterity next. Despite your size, you're very quick. Charisma will follow several of the gods like you and want to help you. Wisdom's a bit low, but intelligence is the dump stat. Hercules gets duped and tricked pretty regularly. If we're sticking to the original myth, you're a half-god on your father's side, so we'll go for Asimar, specifically a Scourge Asimar, as you never grow wings. You get +2 charisma and +1 constitution, 60 feet of dark vision, Celestial Resistance for resistance to radiant and necrotic damage, Lightbearer for the light cantrip, and Healing Hands, letting you heal someone an amount equal to your level as an action once per long rest, in case your girlfriend gets captured by the Lord of the Underworld. It happens. For your background, take Folk Hero for animal handling skill, and swap Survival for acrobatics. It's more useful for you. We'll kick things off as a paladin, giving you 2 skills from their list. Take Athletics and Persuasion. You get Lay on Hands, which is a pool of healing equal to 5 times your paladin level you can use to heal people as an action. You also get Divine Sense, letting you detect celestials, fiends, or undead within 60 feet of you, an amount of times per day equal to your charisma modifier. This would be great to figure out if a minion of Hades was manipulating you. Now, whether or not you're clever enough to actually use it, that's another issue. Second level paladins get a fighting style. Protection lets you use your reaction to force someone attacking an ally within 5 feet of you to roll with disadvantage. You've got to be wearing a shield to get this benefit, which is fine. Longsword and shield is probably your most in-character way for you to fight. You also get some spells. Heroism gives a creature you touch immunity to being frightened and temporary HP equal to your charisma modifier at the start of each of their turns. You can use this on yourself, and really, it's in character. You're all about being a hero. If you'd rather deal some extra damage, use Divine Smite. It lets you spend a spell slot to deal an extra 2d8 radiant damage and deal an extra d8 to fiends or undead, so Hades' minions are really gonna hate this one. Third level paladins get divine health, making you immune to disease, so no sick days while you're training. You can also pick a sacred oath. Oath of Devotion gives you 2 options for a channel of divinity, basically asking your dad for help. Sacred Weapon lets you add your charisma modifier to attack rolls for 1 minute. It counts as magical and creates a 20-foot bright light, so if your allies are having some trouble seeing in the depths of the underworld, this should help them out. Your other option is Turn the Unholy, forcing all undead and fiends within 30 feet of you to make a wisdom save of 8 plus your proficiency bonus and charisma modifier. Failing that, they have to dash away from you. Finally, as an Asimar, you get some godlike power at the third level with Radiant Consumption. This deals radiant damage equal to half your level to creatures within 10 feet of you, and you can add radiant damage equal to your level to 1 attack per round for a minute. Keep in mind that AoE radiant damage does affect you, but taking damage to deal more damage fits the whole martyrdom aspect of Hercules pretty well. Fourth level paladins get an ability score improvement or a feat, and we'll stick to ability scores for now. Round up your strength and constitution for bigger hits and to take bigger hits. Fifth level paladins get extra attack, letting you attack twice instead of once as an action. You can also learn second level spells. Magic Weapon gives you +1 to attack and damage rolls for up to an hour. Put some divine oomph into your hits. 6th level paladins get Aura of Protection, letting allies add your charisma modifier to their saving throws while you're within 10 feet of them, adding some more protection from fireballs and blights. 7th level devotion paladins get Aura of Devotion, another 10-foot radius that makes your allies immune to being charmed. And really, who could betray Hercules? He's such a nice boy. 8th level paladins get another ability score improvement. More strength means more damage, which means Hydras die faster and Thebes stays safer longerer. 9th level paladins can learn 3rd level spells. Remove Curse removes a curse on one person or an object, so you can free any would-be paramours from the clutches of a nefarious uncle. 10th level paladins get Aura of Courage, making allies within 10 feet of you immune to being frightened, and really, what do you have to fear when you've got Hercules in your corner? 11th level paladins get improved Divine Smite, adding a permanent 1d8 radiant damage to all melee weapon attacks, with potentially more from Divine Smite. Get your sword glowing and handle those labors. This will help with almost all of them, except cleaning the Augean stables. For that, you just need Lysol. 12th level paladins get another ability score improvement, and we can finally cap our strength to be the strongest non-god in the world. 13th level paladins can learn 4th level spells, find greater steeds, summons an awesome steed, and we'll go for a Pegasus. but there are other great options. Check out the spell in Xanathar's Guide to Everything for a full list. After spending 10 minutes to cast this, you can summon or dismiss the steed as an action. If it dies, it just goes to a farm up state until you cast this again. Pegasus are amazing. They have a flying speed of 90 feet, which in addition to being fast, also gives you amazing aerial mobility. Bouncing over to Fighter now, first level fighters get another fighting style. Defense adds 1 to your AC while you're wearing armor. Putting a shield with this and full plate will bring you to a comfortable 21 AC. You're terrible at sneaking, but who cares? Your AC is 21. You also get second wind, letting you heal 1d10 plus your fighter level as a bonus action once per short rest. More endurance helps you stay in the fight. Second level fighters get Action Surge, letting you make an extra action once per short rest. Considering each of your attacks has an extra D8 radiant damage to attack, this means you're going to be doing a lot of damage very quickly. Third level fighters can choose a martial archetype, and while champion might also work, I'm going for Cavalier. You can grab another skill proficiency, I'd go for history, as eventually you'll find out why your namesake keeps trying to murder you. You're born to the saddle, which gives you advantage on dexterity saves to stay on your mount, and you can hop on with 5 feet of movement instead of half. Finally, you get Unwavering Mark, meaning that when you hit a creature with a melee attack, you can mark it, making it have disadvantage on attack rolls against any creature that isn't you. If it does manage to hit someone else, you get a special bonus action attack against them next turn, dealing extra damage equal to half your fighter level. That extra damage isn't a lot, but having a third attack per turn with an extra D8 radiant damage is. Fourth level fighters can grab an ability score improvement or a feat, and we're actually going to take a late game feat with the mounted combatant feat. This lets you get advantage on melee attacks against creatures smaller than your mount, so medium or smaller. You can take hits for your mount and soak up damage for them, and if your mount has to make a dexterity save, they take half damage on a failed save and no damage on a success. Keep in mind, your Pegasus gets to add your charisma modifier to all its saves, and it already has a +4 to dex saves, so this should be very helpful. Back over to Paladin, 14th level paladins get Cleansing Touch, which is basically the same thing as that Remove Curse spell, but you have an amount of these equal to your charisma modifier to use for free, which is great when you're dealing with the God of Death on a semi-regular basis. 15th level paladins get Purity of Spirit, meaning you're permanently under the effects of protection from evil and good spells. This means aberrations, celestials, fiends, fae, and undead have disadvantage on attack rolls against you, and you already can't be charmed or frightened because of your auras, but you would get advantage on those saves as well. This is huge, as late game these types of enemies become very common. Our capstone is 16th level of paladin, and we could invest in constitution for more HP, but I'm going to go for the tough feat instead, giving you an extra 40 HP to keep you alive and in the fight. Now that we've hit level 20, let's figure out how good of a build this is. First, you can deal great damage with extra radiant damage on each hit, a maxed out modifier, an extra attack. You'll be slaying monsters left and right. You're also an incredible tank with over 20 AC, over 200 HP, methods for healing yourself. You're gonna be in the fight for a very long time. Finally, you can fly 90 feet per round on the Pegasus with advantage hit medium creatures and the ability to take damage for the mount. It's really the best pet a guy could ask for. As far as weaknesses go, a 10 minute casting time on Find Greater Steed means it's not useful in emergencies. Cast it in the morning with the rest of the party getting ready, otherwise you're gonna have to go without it. You're also very bad at stealth, clanking around in heavy armor, and you only have +1 to dex to fix that. You're gonna get busted if you ever have to be clandestine. Finally, you're lacking in wisdom and intelligence, which means failed saves and just not being super helpful outside of combat. But in combat, you're a true hero. Get up on the Hydra's back, deal some massive damage, and take all the hits. Just remember, you're easily tricked, and losing control could make your story a lot less family friendly. Thanks for watching. If you like the video, subscribe for more. We do 2 builds every week. Make sure you come back next week. We've got something from the Eastern Shores and someone who could sail you there.